Wasi Kukola, and I will be talking about our work on underwater optical wireless communication in turbulence and random sea surveys in this session. So I'm from the University of Edinburgh and School of Engineering, and this work is done together with members of my research group. The names of these members are listed in this slide. The outline of my talk is as follows. I'll talk a little bit about introduction, and then I'll talk about the challenges of underwater optical wireless communications. Then I'll introduce subcarrier intensity modulation for underwater optical wireless communication. That is a technique that we've been working on in my group for quite some time now. Then I'll present some empirical results, and then we'll discuss those results, and the concluding remarks will be given thereafter. So why do we study underwater optical wireless communications? First of all, this is what can be referred to as the last frontier in high-speed optical wireless connectivity, meaning that in terrestrial, even in space, we can achieve unbelievable high speed of wireless communication. But that is yet not possible in underwater communications. Therefore, it is referred to as the last frontier when it comes to high-speed wireless connectivity. The underwater communication is important for so many reasons, not least for environmental protection, for socio-economic activities such as mineral mining, for oil and gas exploration, for safety and rescue mission as well, and also for national security purposes. We use underwater for communication between submarines and so on and so forth. Communication relies currently on acoustic waves, and that means the bandwidth is very limited and the speed of communication is very, very low, typically 2 kilobits per second currently. And the economic value of underwater communication is about $2.86 billion by 2023, according to a particular projection given on this slide. The underwater channel is very hostile to radio frequency waves, and that is why the advances that we've made in terrestrial communication and in space communication cannot be transferred directly to underwater, because those advances are based on radio wave propagation, and radio waves do not travel very well in underwater because underwater channel can be conductive, and then it attenuates the radio wave very, very significantly. Therefore, we want to explore the use of optical signal for wireless communication in underwater. One of the advantages of using optical signal is we have huge unlicensed bandwidth available, and the devices are matured, and they can consume very little power, and the latency can be very, very low as well. So we have a vision for how to link up the underwater with the terrestrial and the space communication that already enjoy fast wireless communication speed. And that vision entails using optical beam in the underwater to connect. For example, in this illustration, we have sensors that can be linked up to a hub to aggregate all the data in the underwater using light-based communication. Wireless light-based. And then we have an object on the surface. In this case, it could be a bio, or it could be a boat, or it could be an ROV that comes in to harvest all the data from the hub. And then that can be linked to the outside or to the backbone using whether light-based communication or radio-based communication, as illustrated in this diagram. That is what we envision to happen in order to make sure the underwater network is linked to the backbone that already enjoy high-speed communication. Some of the challenges listed above. So the first challenge that we want to talk about here relates to the random motion of this sea surface. Okay, and here we say if you look at the sea surface and it moves randomly depending on the wind speed and the wind direction, that means the buoy that we put here as an illustration, this buoy is our receiver. For example, that means the motion of the buoy will also become random. The body of it might tilt, it might move, sideways or forward or up and down. All of those motions are possible. And when that happens, that means we suffer from misalignment. So primarily, the consequence of the random sea surface is misalignment of the link. The beam here, for example, the misalignment is represented as letter R, small letter R. And that is caused by the motion of the barb due to the random sea surface here. The motion can be along the Y, it can be along the X, it could be along the Z. Put together, it causes a misalignment of the beam. And the link range is represented as DR. This DR, due to the motion of the sea surface, can also, change as well. And the mean value is represented by the dotted line. Therefore, we have our, you know, the effective arc, if you like, the misalignment has given us the misalignment in the x direction plus misalignment in the y direction. So that is our small letter r, and the geometry is shown in this figure. Whereas delta d represents the vertical movement, that is the change in the link range due to the random sea surface. Due to that movement caused by the wind speed, we can then evaluate the variance of the misalignment. As I've said, we can have misalignment in the x direction, we can have misalignment in the y direction, we can have misalignment in the z direction. The variance for each one of them is as given on this slide, and they are all related. So when that happens, we can develop the probability density function for those misalignments. Since we know their variances, and we know that each one of them is kind of Gaussian, therefore we can combine the two of them together based on this expression that says, you know, equilibrium distance between Rx and Ry, and that is given as R. So we find the PDF of the misalignment R, given by this expression here. We can also follow the same process and find the PDF of delta D. Delta D again represents the vertical movement, that is the change in the link range of the system. And that change is also Gaussian with variance delta sigma D squared here. So if you put all of that together, and if you consider simple on-off Kinyi modulation, that is where you turn the light on to transmit a bit 1 and you turn the light off to transmit a bit 0. So the bit error rate, that is a metric that measures the amount of error in our transmission, is given by this equation here. This is not taking into account any variation, any misalignment at all. So this is the expression for the bit error. Take the instantaneous bit error rate and then average it over the variable's position and delta d. If we estimate this equation, if you solve this expression, that gives us the average bit error rate performance, and the influence of random sea surface is then captured. So if we do all of that, and then we get, you know, if you consider all of these parameters for the simulation, we're looking at about 10 centimeters in terms of variation, 0.01 meter variation, negative to positive only. Okay, so that's the range that we want to consider. If we do that, we see that as we increase, as the speed of the wind increases along this direction, the bit error rate increases. That is to be expected because the wind, increasing wind speed increases the misalignment. It increases the chances of the link being misaligned. And when we misalign, we lose power. Therefore, the bit error rate is going to increase. And also, if you consider a fixed link range, and we increase the transmit power, we expect an increase in power to improve performance, as we can see in this diagram here. The bit error rate is getting lower and lower as we increase transmit power. But by the time you increase your speed, again, the wind speed, as the wind speed increases, the bit error rate increases. So that impact is quite a lot more, is stronger than the impact of increasing the transmit power. Because, you know, even if you increase the transmit power and your link is misaligned, then that increase in power is not received by the receiver. That is why the wind impact is more pronounced, because we have a link that is misaligned. Therefore, we don't benefit from the power increase. And that is what this wants to understand, the impact of this random sea surface on the different water types. So here we are looking at three types of water. We are looking at the clear water, the clear ocean, the coastal water, and the harbor water. The harbor water is one that is very turbid. That means it's got a lot of, you know, scattering, multiple scattering, and high attenuation in there. But because it is highly attenuating, that harbor water, it means that the received signal power is weak anyway. For the other two, particularly in the clear water, the transmission there is good, we can get good signal, but as wind speed increases, then the bit error rate deteriorates, as we see here. And in a similar way for the coastal water, because it's the underwater turbulence. Turbulence is caused by refractive index fluctuation along the path of the optical beam, and that can be caused by temperature changes or salinity or even water bubbles. And what that means is that the received signal, you know, fluctuates up and down in the system, and that causes detection error and reliability issues for an optical, for an underwater optical wireless communication system. So to do that, we have a test bed that we've developed, and this is the block diagram, and this is an image of the testbed for measuring the impact of turbulence in underwater. So what that means is that in this testbed, as you change the temperature gradient here, the received signal begins to fluctuate more and the variance increases. And that's what we see in this diagram. So as the temperature gradient increases, then the variance of the received signal, of the average signal, continues to increase. And then it plateaus. And what we've also observed is that the received signal, if there's no turbulence in the system, is Gaussian, as shown in this figure here. But as you increase the temperature gradient, the turbulence strength increases and the distribution no longer follows Gaussian. It follows more like log normal distribution. That's what we do. So this expression here tells us how we modulate the light to transmit information. For example, if you are using this simple on-off gain that is the state of the art in underwater optical wireless communication, signal MT is given amplitude 1 when you want to transmit a bit 1 and 0 to transmit bit 0. But because of the effect of turbulence, P average is going to change all of the time because turbulence means the received signal is fluctuating. So if P average is fluctuating, when you transmit a 1, then this is fluctuating as well. When you transmit a 0, P average is still fluctuating. So that means the information that resides on the amplitude as shown here is going to be fluctuating in the presence of turbulence. And that causes a problem, because you wouldn't know where zero starts and where one stops. You know, we don't know the decision boundary between one and a zero. So the threshold detection has to be adaptive. But that is complex and can be expensive. So we'd rather not do that. But you cannot use fixed threshold when you use on-off gain because of the effect of turbulence. That is illustrated in this histogram here. So this is transmitting bit zero and bit one. If there's no turbulence, you can see there's a clear decision boundary between them. As soon as turbulence sets in, that boundary disappears. We don't even know where one starts from. We don't know where zero starts from. And that is a challenge when you use the state of the art. And that is why we are studying another technique called subcarrier intensity modulation. With subcarrier intensity modulation, for example, if you look at a similar binary case with subcarrier intensity modulation, in a binary case, bit 1 is represented with a sinusoid with a phase shift of 180 degrees, while bit 0 is a sinusoid with zero phase shift. What that means is that the amplitude is constant here. And when turbulence happens, the phase information where the information resides is preserved. It doesn't change. So we can get our information reliably. And that is the advantage of this technique. Now, this is illustrated here for the binary case. As turbulence increases, as you can see, from the left figure to the right figure, the decision boundary is still very clear. And this is increasing turbulence strength compared to the case of on-off gain that we saw earlier. And that's the beauty of this particular technique. To further illustrate that, we transmit an image of this cone here. This is in still water using the two methods. This is the state of the art on-off gain, and this is the subcarrier intensity modulation. In still water, pretty much you can get the image back for the two techniques. But when turbulence is present, you see the first one here, which is the on-off gain or 2PAM, it's also called the 2PAM pulse amplitude modulation, the image is completely distorted. But with the BPSK SIM, we can still get the image, although with some errors, but a lot better than what we get for the case of on-off gain. And this is in very strong. To further illustrate that, you can use, instead of binary phase shift gain, we can use multi-level. So this is an illustration of the same when there's no turbulence. This is 2 levels, 8 levels, and so on and so forth. We see all the phases, we're using phase shift gain here with SIM. All the phases are quite clear, and we can tell them apart by this boundary line in no turbulence. By the time turbulence sets in, we can see the phases are still very clear. The boundaries are still very clear for the case of 8, for the case of 4, for the case of 6, and also for the case of 2. Although the signals are now spread out a lot more, they come to the center compared to here where they did not come to the center. And that is because, you know, the signal level is changing, so the SNR is varied, but the phase is preserved. And with that, we also compared the same with some other techniques used in literature, and this is the result telling us that when you have turbulence, for example, the yellow one is SIM with quadrature amplitude modulation. So when you have turbulence, as turbulence increases from the x-axis here from 0 to about 0.4 in our experiment, with the yellow one, the performance is still pretty much the same up until 0.14 scintillation index. And then if you go beyond that, then the performance drops. This drop in performance is due to the fact that the average SNR is now very low. And therefore, the performance, and that is the same for all of the other techniques as well. The green one is using a signal processing technique called the bit and power loading. So bit and power loading is really not good in turbulence, because you can see in still water, when turbulence is zero, it's giving us the highest speed. But when turbulence sets in, the performance drops. And that is because the bit and power loading algorithm requires an accurate knowledge of the channel state information. But you can't have that when the channel is fluctuating because of turbulence. Therefore, the performance is not so great. And that is not surprising at all. With that, we come to the conclusion of this stuff. Introduce the impact of the random sea surface and how it affects the performance of an underwater optical wireless communication link. We've also introduced the impact of underwater turbulence on the performance of optical wireless communication in underwater and how that can be mitigated by using subcarrier intensity modulation. Thank you very much.